Thing. And I'm going to share my screen. So my name's Lorna Wagner, and we're delighted to have you with us this morning. Thank you. I'm happy to tell you that out of the registrations, we had careers professionals from England, Ireland, Scotland and Wales that signed up for this session, which is awesome. And you're well spread geographically, which is also really good news. So you're welcome, very welcome to join us. You're welcome to access these recorded resources, which will be saved onto the careers pages of the website afterwards, and share it with teaching colleagues or with other people in your team afterwards. We're not precious about that, Steve, are we? We're quite happy to share the information far and wide. We're also really conscious that each one of you will have a client list of young people or adult job seekers. And so the potential for this information being shared far and wide is huge. And that's really why we do these sessions. So if I just share my screen, I will talk for a very short time, and then I'm going to hand over to the expert. And I'll sum up the meeting. As there's not a massive number of us, I think we can probably handle questions as they go along. Are you happy with that, Steve?
Yeah. Well, what me and Emily agreed was that during the presentation, if you open the chat facility, you can put any questions you have in there, and Emily be on standby to answer any questions, and so we can answer questions at the end as well.
Okay, so please feel free to put your hand up if you want to ask it out loud as well, or put your questions into the chat. We'll answer it as we go along, or pick that up at the end. We've got an hour for this session, so if I just share my screen and I'll do the Maritime UK bit, and then I will hand over to you, if that's okay.
Yeah.
I hate this. This is where it all goes horribly wrong. I'm not very good at sharing my screen. I think after all this time, when I say all this time, a year, but you'd think that you'd be able to do that. So can someone just confirm that you can see that?
I can see it.
Marvellous. Okay, so that's obviously the logo for the Maritime UK Careers Programme. I'm the Programme Manager for Careers and Outreach for the maritime sector. I have a long and very detailed job description, but it really comes down to one statement, which is to help people out there understand what the maritime sector is, the breadth of the sector, why it's thriving, and why it's a really good place for adult job seekers and for young people that are looking to start their careers to explore, to see if they can find the right pathway for them. So today's session is delivered by the Royal Fleet Auxiliary, and I'm really grateful for their support. Emily and Steve and I have been working together for a little while now. My background is that I, up until April last year, I was head of learner journey at Eastleigh College in Hampshire, and managed all the support services there, which included the careers and employability programme and team. We were 6 miles from the international port in Southampton as the crow flies, and I had no idea how big maritime was. I didn't really understand how big it was in terms of the Solent economy, 20% of the local economy in the Solent. And in hindsight, I should have been writing my careers programme with that in mind, and having a much higher highlight and spotlight on the opportunities within the sector. But once I was applying for this job and doing my research, as you do, my mind was blown. I spent the first couple of months of this job just apologising for what I didn't know formally. Then I had a word with myself and a virtual slap around the face, and thought, right, what we've got to do is we've got to take this information to careers professionals as key influencers proactively. So Steve and Emily helped me with a session a couple of weeks ago when we were talking to work coaches at Job Centre Plus, who were delighted to have access to this information. This is obviously in more detail today. And this is one of a whole series of CPD sessions. And I'll come back to that at the end and tell you the other things that are in the diary that you can book onto, and the other things that I've got planned for the end of the year. So, and if you've heard this bit before, apologise, but I'll make it really quick. So the maritime sector employs 1.1 million people in the UK. That's bigger than aviation and rail combined. And the 2050 strategy was written by the Department for Transport about five years ago now, where they looked at the future for the sector. And basically, the bottom line was that the The sector is about to double in size, and they think by 2030. Now, there's all sorts of reasons for that. One of the big ones is the carbon net zero targets, which are in place for 2050, and all the industry, the research, the innovation, the science that is going into that activity. And it's not just about wind farms. This is about cruise ships and cargo ships having an alternative fuel source to diesel. And it's not just about new shipbuilding. It's about the refurbishment that will have to go on for every other ship that has that is still operating in 2050 and has a diesel engine, because it will need a new engine and probably new power sources and potentially big batteries or whichever way that science is going to go. There's also Brexit, dare I say it, if you'll forgive me using that language, but also the Freeports Initiative, which you will have heard of. Another thing that's around at the moment is the shipbuilding strategy. So the government has made a commitment to invest in shipbuilding as an industry. And when the document was first published in the autumn, the end part of 2020, it was very much about the Royal Navy. But that document, the strategy is under a refresh at the moment, and it's being extended to include commercial shipping as well and boat building. So, and that means huge investments, huge incentives. The Freeports Initiative is bigger than any of us can imagine, but they're talking about 170,000 jobs coming out through those 8 freeports. And for those of us that are in the Solent, I live in Hampshire, you know, we're going to have one there, hopefully. And they're talking about 50,000 jobs. And when we're talking about the 2050 strategy, clean maritime, etc., just a word about wind farms. I had been told by a colleague at Hull University some months ago that there was a shortage of 22,000 wind farm technicians in order for the industry to meet the government's wind energy production targets. I was told last week that that has been looked at again. They're now saying 69,000 jobs. And these are obviously predominantly down the east coast of the UK, because that's where most of the wind farms are. But there's the whole infrastructure and the industry behind it, as well as those people that are working at sea, building, maintaining, repairing, and so on, and their well-paid jobs. So there's lots of news coming out that way. The other thing I would say to you is that you know, so the 1.1 million jobs is going to become 2.2 million jobs. So the careers program, through this strategy and through the subsequent people pipeline document, is looking at where these young people are coming from and where these job seekers are coming from. And do they even know what the maritime sector is? Do we honestly know the difference between the Merchant Navy and the Royal Navy? And the answer to that could be no, and that's fine. But that's the purpose of these sorts of sessions. So the Royal Navy is clearly defence. The Merchant Navy is any other working boats, commercial boats. So the other industries that are part of the sector include boat building, shipbuilding, naval architecture, wasn't terminology that I was familiar with formerly. And actually, we've got a CPD session coming up in July, where we're looking at naval architecture, the architecture of ports and harbours and so on, and design-based careers in maritime. Sea fishing, aquaculture and marine science are part of the maritime sector. And I was talking yesterday with people from the National Oceanography Centre, one person who was in Southampton and somebody else who was up in Liverpool, but don't you just love Zoom meetings, the way we can do that now, and talking to them about the number of opportunities for marine science. But actually the NOC are not just looking to employ graduates with marine science or natural sciences qualifications. They're looking for computer technicians and computer scientists. They're interested in maths graduates, physics graduates, etc., etc. It's got 600 scientists that work for them. So I'm doing a bit of work with them at the moment, learning about careers there. And actually, we'll be doing a promotion on that on World Oceans Day on the 8th of June. So look out for that. Super yachts and leisure boats are part of the maritime sector as well. Super yachts are defined as those that have a professional crew. I would have told you formerly they are the really big ones, the really expensive ones. But super yachting can be a fab opportunity for a young person who's looking to do something different. You know, they've done their A-levels, they've done their level three study, and they want a gap year, and yet they can find themselves working on a super yacht and building a career that way. And again, it's not just about being at sea, it's about the whole industry behind it, the design, the brokerage, the sales, the rent, the staffing, recruitment agencies that specifically look at crew for super yachts. And that's another CPD session that we've got coming up shortly. Careers at sea and super yacht crewing in next month, in June. Ports, harbours and marinas are really interesting. So yeah, of course they're part of the maritime sector, but if I'd said that to you at the beginning, you probably would have said the Royal Navy, you probably would have said cargo ships, you might have said cruise ships, you might have talked about ferries going across the Isle of Man or the Isle of Wight, or you know, across the channel or whatever. But I wonder how many people would have remembered to drop in ports, harbours and marinas. And the things about ports is it's just a large business. So they, Portsmouth International Port, employ 3,500 people. They have a logistics team, they have a security team, they have a finance team, they have a marketing and PR team, and so on. But ports, because of the Free Ports Initiative, are about to really expand in size. So there's a super organization to be looking at, regardless of which business discipline, if you like, a young person is looking to do. But it's a great way of looking for a sustainable career. Cruise has obviously taken a massive battering over the last year, but isn't it wonderful that the cruise ships are leaving Weymouth Bay mostly, and they're getting back into use. And the fantastic footage over the weekend with the Iona coming into Southampton for the naming ceremony and heading off on her maiden voyage. So that is recovering. But cruise is a huge industry. And we're told that every time a cruise ship comes into port in Southampton, it brings £1 million into the local economy. Leisure boating is obviously a boat that you own yourself, or a club that you join, but sailing lessons or people that have their own boats, yachts, etc. Leisure boats, someone told me recently, leisure boats tend to be white, is an easy way to find them. But I had a day out in the summer last year between the lockdowns. We went across to Brownsea Island in Poole Harbour. And when we came back and we're sitting having your obligatory ice cream on the waterside, really, and watching what was going on, I was suddenly struck by the number of people that were wearing a dark blue T-shirt with Poole Harbour on it that were crew and that were staff. That was a Sunday afternoon. I'd never really seen it before. I'd never thought about a marina or a harbour like that as being a place of work. But once, it's one of those things, once you see it, you can't unsee it. And I was stunned by these worker ants almost that were busying around getting people onto boats, getting them off boats, getting their luggage onto boats, helping people find moorings, talking to each other on walkie talkies and all the rest. What a fab place to work. And as I say, once you've seen it, you can't unsee it. So the Merchant Navy we talked about, but that's primarily careers at sea. So that's shipping and cargo ships and fuel transfer and so on. And the thing about the Merchant Navy is another word that you may never have heard of before, but cadet ships. So apprenticeships we know about. I don't need to tell you what an apprenticeship is. And the maritime sector uses apprenticeships to a large extent. But cadet ships are kind of an alternative for a career at sea. And they follow different models. Someone that I was in a meeting with the other day was talking that their training organisation does a 7-month, 5-month split. 7 months on land at a marine school and then 5 months at sea, putting into practice what you've learned at the school. And cadet ships will be 3 or 4 years long, generally, depending on which pathway you follow. Again, a bit like apprenticeships, different pathways, different disciplines. The big difference is you're not employed, though. You are given a sponsorship contract by a shipping company to undertake your cadetship, which hopefully, obviously, will lead to employment at the end of it. You can take on a cadetship at 16. You can go to sea at 16, but it's much more common for people to do that at 18. And I would suggest if someone was doing that, then either the STEM subjects or perhaps something like public services at college would be a really good feeder qualification into a cadetship. Inland waterways are also included. So we talked about the Isle of Man ferry or the Isle of Wight ferry, but that's also canals and river traffic. So you've only got to go and stand on Waterloo Bridge in London to see the traffic that's going on there. A lady joined a training meeting we did recently talking about her business, which is running a marina for canal boats and a boat building yard there. And that's also part of the maritime sector. Work boats and tugs are included. A particular favourite of mine. I've got a real soft spot for them. They just look so little compared to the massive ships that they are bringing into port safely. But I was told the other day that the average length of a tug is only 3 meters shorter than Big Ben is tall. So actually, they're much bigger than we think. But that's, you know, if someone is looking for a different sort of job where they're not going to go into the office and sit in an office in front of a computer all day and they want something that's a bit different, how exciting would that be? And if I'd had my time again, I think I might fancy that myself. And then finally, business services. So the business services that support all these other businesses, I've said at the top there, careers at sea and on shore, 75% of the 1.1 million jobs are on shore in maritime. And we make it possible for the 25% to go to sea. And that's all the usual business services, as I described when I said about the port, customer service, finance, HR, marketing, PR, logistics, security, catering, et cetera, et cetera. But there is also specialist business services in the maritime sector, such as maritime law, such as shipbrokers, such as surveyors that are looking after boats and making sure that they pass the equivalent of their MOT. So what we would say to you is that the sector is about to double in size. So it's a really good time for you to be learning more about the sector so that when you're having those conversations with young people or adult job seekers that you remember to mention maritime. I have this dream, to quote someone rather famous, that when a careers professional is sitting down with a job seeker or a young person who perhaps is interested in carpentry and joinery, and when you're having been in that position many times, you kind of do the standard. You say, oh, okay, so are you looking at being a joiner or a carpenter outside? Are you looking at being on a building site, or are you looking at cabinet making, or are you interested in being a kitchen fitter or to work for that sort of organization, or are you looking to be self-employed and to be your own boss and run your own carpentry and joinery business, have your name on the van and all the rest, all those conversations that we have with people that careers professionals would remember to say, or have you thought about boat building? Oh my goodness, wouldn't that be exciting? Wouldn't it be great to be a carpenter or a joiner working on a super yacht and becoming a master craftsman in that sort of environment? So there's a colleague that I work with in this sector, and he and I played this little game. I think really it was part of my induction, which was, Lorna, come up with a job that you think you can't find in the maritime sector, and I'll tell you where it is. And we've been playing that job, that game, for 13 months now. And I'm yet to come up with one. And I suppose that's my closing gambit. The jobs that exist within the sector, it's difficult to come up with one that I can't tell you where to place it, or my colleague Ian could tell you where to place it. But today we're going to concentrate on the Royal Fleet Auxiliary. So that's my bit done for now. So I'll stop sharing my screen. New slide. I'll hand over to my colleagues Emily and to Steve, who both work for the Royal Fleet Auxiliary, and they're going to tell you about their organisation and career pathways and opportunities and so on. So I'm going to stop talking now, if that's okay, Steve.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us, and thank you, Lorna, for inviting us to the session so we can spread the word on our organisation. I'm joined here today with my colleague Emily, who works in the office with me when we're in the office and not working virtually. So I'll be giving a presentation, should take about 20 minutes. I've shortened it a bit because I've been having some technical issues, particularly where video audio is concerned. So I've removed a couple of videos. If you open the chat facility, as mentioned earlier, type in any questions you'll have, and Emily will be on hand to answer them as I'm talking. And you'll see our contact details on the end, including a contact email address where you can send us any queries you have, and we can answer you by email as well. So I'm just going to attempt to share my screen, which seems to be the only way it works. So if you could give us a thumbs up if you can see, Laura.
Yeah, we can see that, please.
Excellent. Right. Okay, so I was invited by Lorna, talking to Lorna during a webinar a few weeks ago, where she invited me to give a presentation at this event. She asked if I could maybe bring in somebody who has gone through a journey to get where they are in the RFA. And I've been thinking long and hard of who to bring in. And then I figured, well, why not me? Because I owe a lot to the RFA. Since joining the RFA some 14 years ago, I've been able to work my way up from nothing to where I am now, working alongside some of the most professional people I have ever met. So right now, I am one of the outreach staff officers working in RFA recruitment alongside Emily, and we're assigned to promote and recruit officers for the RFA. By trade, I'm a qualified Marine Engineering Officer of the Watch and a Weapons Maintenance Officer. I initially applied to be a trainee motorman some time ago, as I didn't have the required entry qualifications to come in as an engineering officer, which is what I really wanted to do. But I came in anyway, having completed my engineering technician diploma as a civilian at a civilian engineering college. I worked towards getting my advanced apprenticeship in engineering through the Royal Navy, which took me to the rate of leading hand. But my goals were still set on becoming an engineering officer. So I figured, how am I going to achieve this? I'm going to have to undertake additional studies. So I applied to the Marine Society for the Slater Fund, which is a fantastic charitable organisation. And they funded me toward obtaining my qualifications that I needed in order to apply for the RTO scheme, which stands for Rating to Officer, which is a transitional step to becoming an officer based upon your experience and documented skills and expertise. So then what was next? It was the Admiralty Interview Board. So much like my Royal Navy colleagues, we'll have to go through the AIB, it's called. I failed it the first time and I had to wait a whole year before I was eligible to apply again. But I used that time to prepare myself, look at my strengths and weaknesses, and develop myself in order to pass it. So I passed it second time round, and then went through Britannia Royal Naval College for I think it was about 11 or 12 weeks at the time, undertaking lots of military training. And then eventually, after some short time at Nautical College, I became qualified as an engineering officer of the watch, with an unrestricted certificate of competency, and I'm also qualified as an advanced weapons maintainer. I've had the opportunity to work around the world, and I've also been seconded to the UK Border Force for a period of time. So over the years, I have accumulated numerous supplementary qualifications, ranging from leadership and management to propulsion engine fitter, workshop machinist, amongst many other skills over a very broad spectrum. And most of this has been sponsored by the RFA. So that's me and my journey. In this presentation, I'm going to talk about who the RFA are, not the RAF, as sometimes it gets confused with, and how we link in with the Royal Navy, an overview of the career options that we have, what life is like on board, and our application procedure. So Lorna mentioned earlier about the link between the Royal, the difference between the Royal Navy and the Merchant Navy. We are kind of the link between the Royal Navy and the Merchant Navy. We are a branch of the Royal Navy. So the Royal Fleet Auxiliary, we're a world-class maritime operational support force, predominantly civilian manned. We provide logistical and operational support for the Royal Navy's activities worldwide, including NATO exercise and operations. We were established in 1905 The RFA was historically supplying the ships with stores, ammunition and fuel, which began as coal transportation bunkers. We have the capability to operate in any part of the world, including war zones where normal commercial shipping cannot. During the World War II, the RFA seen action in every naval theatre of operations from the Arctic to the Pacific. We supported more recent military operations during the Falklands conflict of 82, Bosnian War of the 90s, both Gulf Wars, the Libyan military intervention of 2011. And we are currently still active in the Persian Gulf, ensuring safe passage of trade routes through hostile waters where there are still threats from foreign interference and piracy. So we also play a key role in humanitarian operations directed by the Foreign and Commonwealth Office, including the recent Ebola crisis in Sierra Leone 2014, and our ongoing hurricane disaster relief efforts in the Caribbean. So this gives the UK a key asset to respond to emerging crises due to our constant state of high readiness. Out of season, our Caribbean deployed platforms will also carry out counter-narcotic operations, working closely with the US Coast Guard, disrupting the flow of illegal drug activities through British overseas territories up to the United States, which inevitably will arrive on UK shores. The RFA also maintain regular foreign engagements, sharing the Royal Navy's commitments to overseas territories and reassuring our allies and flying the flag for Great Britain. While this has not traditionally been a key focus for the Royal Navy, the RFA has grown more in importance as ever more complex surface fleet require replenishment, repair and support. The ace card of the RFA is our ability to replenish vessels whilst at sea, Royal Navy vessels, NATO vessels. The evolution known as a RAS, which stands for replenishment at sea, is the capability to pump fuel, water, or transfer pallets of stores, ammunition, and food from one ship to another whilst both ships are moving through water. Our Bay class ships are equipped with floodable docks and are able to deploy many craft and vehicles from the stern to support our amphibious operations. They can accommodate a high volume of Royal Marine Commandos, their vehicles and equipment, and Army personnel also. We're also on hand to assist with repairs to other surface ships, submarines, shoreside equipment where required, offer medical support with hospital facilities, and our helicopters and fast boats extend our capabilities even further. In addition to the roles taken on due to our ship's greater capabilities, we also undertake ever more NATO task force operations. Technological advances in warfare have brought about new challenges, which we have had to embrace and adapt to. However, whilst the RFA is part of the wider naval service, its military standing is more defensive rather than offensive, but we are able to deliver maritime surveillance, security and policing, and a command platform to launch military operations from. So this means working closely with other arms of the MOD and even allied forces. Our ships are also occasionally used by UK special forces for training evolutions, but the weapons we carry are for our own self-defense, manned by either crew on board or assigned force protection teams, usually the Royal Marine Commandos now. So, RFA personnel are employed as civil servants of the Crown. By civilian, this is not to say we are in any way inexperienced with military. In fact, many RFA employees are former military service personnel in some form, or at least trained to the same standards. We also deploy with a range of current military staff in order to deliver our output. New entrants are given initial training at a Royal Navy establishment, depending on the role they're going for. So for officer cadets, you'll have to attend Britannia Royal Naval College, Dartmouth, where you are trained to be a naval officer, upholding the traditions and standards, as well as developing leadership skills. Other junior rates will also begin at a naval training establishment, depending on the role, whether you will develop the skills needed to become an effective RFA sailor. all new entrants are subject to sign the sponsored reserve agreement. So this is where that step is. You become a special member of the Naval Reserve, which basically means at times of war or activation, you cannot be treated as a pirate, mercenary or spy. So employees serving with other reserve forces like the TA or the R&R would not be eligible for RFA sponsored reserve membership, so they would need to transfer. We also undertake additional unique training to give a broader range of skills, such as damage control, first aid, chemical, biological, radioactive, nuclear, respirator training, more extensive firefighting, warfare and weapons training, all depending on the role that you're in. All this in addition to the required civilian certification training, which is required by the International Maritime Organization Manila updates. Entrants will be employed as Crown civil servants with no specified duration or upper age restriction. You can work in the RFA until pensionable age, subject to medical standards. The pension scheme is not a military pension scheme. It is a career average defined benefit pension scheme for civil servants. And even as civil servants in naval establishments, we are expected to conduct ourselves to the same high standards as the rest of the service, which include personal conduct and showing marks of respect to those of seniority. There may be also occasions where we will be invited to attend ceremonial events where parade training may be necessary, which isn't all a bad thing, especially when you're in the Caribbean. So the future is bright. We have recently appointed four new next generation replenishment tankers and are currently in the design phase for our new solid support class. And plans are in motion exploring the wider scope for more versatile modular type vessels, extending capabilities for aviation, training, repair, support and medical even further, adding to our capability and value. I've got a short video here. You might get the sound, you might not, but it's only like a minute long, I think.
The RFA's core role is to support the Royal Navy through issuing of stores and fuel at sea.
Our link to the Royal Navy is really good. We all work together for a common cause, dealing with counter-narcotic operations, hurricane relief, disaster relief out in the Caribbean. Every time you do something, you feel like you're making a better world out of it.
You get to see quite a lot of the world for the RFA. We went out to the Arctic Circle, been to Spain and Portugal.
Out to Japan, North Africa, Mediterranean, West Coast of America, through the Caribbean.
Done a fair bit of travelling away from work, but the opportunity to be able to get paid for it as well, superb.
I'd say the perks of the job is definitely the leave. You know, work 4 months and then you get 3 months off. We know our exact date that we'd be paying off, and then we can kind of plan our lives when we get home, like travelling the world, going on nice holidays, spending time with family and friends.
In the RFA especially, you know, onboard life is really good. We have good social time on board, gyms on board, the cabins are really nice.
You can personalise your cabin to however you want, posters up, your own bed sheets.
Like fairy lights and loads of little stupid things that actually make it more homely.
The people that I'm going to be working with and learning the trade with are going to be friends for life.
Everybody looks out for each other, and I really admire that. The RFA is just one big family. I just see it as my RFA family.
You're going to different locations every day, you're meeting new people, tasting new foods, having new experiences. Nothing shoreside can compete with it.
So there's five departments in the RFA, or thereabouts, which have different roles. To start with, we've got CIS, which stands for Communications and Information Systems. They deal with classified information in a sensitive manner, radio operation, and all the traditional things like Morse code, flags, and signals. The deck department, they do watchkeeping, navigation, the warfare officers as well, cargo handling, berthing, replenishment at sea and helicopter operations, the systems engineers, or ETOs, the company known as now, electrotechnical officers. They deal with communication systems, radar, sensitive equipment, auxiliary machinery, high voltage, or anything electrical, really. You've got the marine engineers. They deal with propulsion, power, water generation, sewage, air conditioning, repairs and maintenance, fire equipment, and weapons maintenance. We've got the logistics department, which are catering, silver service. We've got chefs preparing nutritional meals, laundry services, stores and accounting, supplies, and stock management. All departments coordinate ship's husbandry and their areas of responsibility, and all have secondary duties for emergency and training operations. So one question I get quite a lot of from candidates is, how do we fall into the Royal Navy's requirement for fitness? So we require all candidates to pass an ENG1 medical and receive a full 2-year unrestricted certificate. This standard is the Merchant Seafarer Standard, not the Royal Navy Seafarer Standard. And that's set out in Merchant Shipping Notice 1886. And this can be found online at the .gov website. Whilst there is no stipulated requirement for fitness outside of the ENG1 medical standards, generally officers undertaking training will be expected to do leadership tasks which have a physical aspect. You should also be able to swim and have confidence in the water, although it's not a requirement to pass the military swim test. Living and working at sea can be quite physical. There's ladders to climb, weights to carry, extreme climates and confined spaces. Combined with high tempo training, it's easy to see why an RFA seafarer requires a standard of fitness beyond that expected of a medical ENG1. In addition to a drug and alcohol policy, there is now a new no smoking policy. It's the 1st of June it gets implemented, where there is no smoking throughout the Ministry of Defence, including on ships. However, electronic vaping devices are still permitted in designated areas. So here is a very brief breakdown of the recruitment process. But to put it simply, if a candidate doesn't hold GCSEs of A to C or 4 to 9 or equivalent, you can apply for any apprenticeship apart from the communications apprenticeships, which require English and maths grades A to C, but everything else is open. For cadetships, it's currently A to C in maths, English language and dual sciences with 2 additional subjects at A to C. For logistics trainees, as in logistics officers trainees, a relevant degree to the role. But the entering requirements do change often depending on business needs, so the latest can be found on the Royal Navy website. So, at Britannia Royal Naval College Dartmouth, there will be militarisation, boat driving, weapons handling, leadership, discipline, amongst many other items that uphold the traditions and values of the RFA. When appointed to a maritime college, there will be academic lectures, hands-on courses, simulators, and learning seafaring skills, combined with examinations and practical assessments, combined with sea phases where you can learn on the job with a task book and mentoring from other qualified personnel. In training, a cadet's salary starts at around £17,000 a year, rising slightly annually. And after qualifying, the starting salary jumps up to over £36,000 a year. For apprenticeships, after initial training at a Royal Naval establishment, onboard training for around 2 to 3 years will gain industry-recognised qualifications and skills depending on the chosen role. Once qualified, a junior rate and salary starts at around £28,000 a year. Another video.
Hi, I'm going to show you my cabin on board. I have lots of space to relax after a hard day at work, but lots of storage space for my clothing and bits and bobs. and a great size desk for my laptop and also my record player. Got a good size double bed as well, and a large TV. Also, I share a shower and bathroom with one other person on board. I'm going to show you where we eat on board. This is the officer's dining room. Come in. Although this is for the officers, the junior rates dining room is much bigger. Different watches may eat at different times, and the food is really varied, as well as having lots of fresh fruit you can help yourself to. The good thing is we've got a gym on board. Let me take you in. In here, like any other gym, we've got running machines, cycling machines, and free weights. The good thing is people can keep fit whilst at sea. I'm now going to show you the junior rates lounge. Come in. This is where we relax after a hard day at work. We share it with roughly 60 other people. In here, we watch TV together. We have quiz nights. We have a bar, which has got Wi-Fi. And for good measure, we have lots of darts competitions. This has been my quick guide to RFA Tide Race. Thank you very much.
Well, that was one of our enthusiastic apprentices doing a little tour of what it's like on board ship. I'd love to see that record player in action when as well as the ships at sea, mate. But life on board in RFA, it's never the same. Each trip is different and the tempo is fast-paced. You'll get to meet some interesting characters and friends for life. You'll always have the support of a colleague on board when you need it. General amenities on board. You've got the bars, email, limited Wi-Fi, satellite phone access, library, gym, magazine subscriptions. There's also an amenities fund that can be applied for things like computer games or events ashore. And we've also got compassionate considerations. At times of family bereavement, the RFA have a reputation of going above and beyond to get you home where possible. Once qualified, you'll get your own cabin and you'll have a leave ratio of 3 months or every 4 months at sea. And you've also got membership to the Civil Service Pension Scheme, as mentioned earlier. So to apply, you've got the Royal Navy website there, or search RFA jobs. You can also email us on that email address, and we can get back to you via Emily if you've got any queries. And I've got one final video, and that has the email address in that as well. All the time, keep you on the side. Okay, that's the end of my presentation. I'll see if I can get the screen back.
Was that you doing that backflip, Steve?
Don't be silly.
So we've got a little bit of time. I'm hearing a delay on the sound. That's not great, is it? Has anyone got any questions for us? Or Emily, is there anything that you want to add to that? I mean, I just think it's fascinating. And genuinely, before I started in this job, I knew nothing about these opportunities. Steve, the size of the RFA, am I right in thinking there's less than 2,000 people that work for it? 1,800, yeah. Something like that?
As it stands at the moment, I think it's about 1,800 personnel. But because we've got new ships coming in, we are looking to expand that with the right personnel. But it's not that big, is it?
No.
For one of the biggest British shipping organisations.
But you're in many locations nationally, and apprenticeships, are they opportunities that tend to start in the autumn term, or is it an all year round thing? I mean, when should we be telling job seekers to be checking out your website? What's the best time of year?
As it stands at the minute, apprenticeships are generally intakes of about 3 a year spread out. Depending on the role that you start in, depends on when it starts. For cadetships, the intakes are June and October, and for qualified entrants, February. If there's any senior ticket holders, we would look to employ them at any time in the year, really, depending on which ticket they hold and how much we need that ticket. So, yeah, about twice a year for cadets and about three times a year for apprenticeships. And it also coincides with the Nautical College intakes as well.
And do you have to be 18?
So we've recently changed the entry criteria for officer cadets, where you do have to be over 18. Quite simply because Britannia Royal Naval College is unable to accommodate under 18s at the moment. This is still yet to be set in stone, but for apprentices, it's 16 school leavers from 16 can join off 15 and 8 months, I think it is.
When they've officially left school. Once you get past what used to be the official school leaving date, but I think with the endpoint assessments rather than exams, it's all a bit complex at the moment. There is a question. There's someone here. Sue has said, I'm almost ashamed to admit I've been a bit ignorant in this area. Sue, you and I are in the same club, because so was I, but that's what the programme's trying to do, is to bring this information to you proactively. So please don't feel bad about it, because you can't know what you don't know. But what's important is we just put this out there. Someone has said that they're going to put in an application. Do you know what? If I was a bit younger, I'd be putting in an application myself. And I've got a 21-year-old that doesn't know what he wants to do with his life. And I keep saying to him, you need to go to Seaboy. There's really exciting jobs out there. The only, please keep asking us questions. The other things I just wanted to finish off with, really, if I can just, oh, here we go. I'm going to try and share my screen again briefly. This is where it'll all go horribly wrong, but. So, I hope you can see that. Really, what can Maritime UK do to help you? Well, some of you will already be part of our careers professionals network. That is open to careers advisors, careers leaders, teachers, tutors, people that work in Job Centre Plus, anyone who's working in an information and guidance role, really. We've even got one lady who is a very active member who's part of a Citizens Advice Bureau team in a coastal community because she talks to people about work all the time. So really, that's our way of communicating directly with you. We can tell you about upcoming CPD opportunities, networking meetings, when there's new resources available, and so on. We've got the Maritime Careers area is packed with resources, which you are welcome to use. The videos are all stored onto YouTube. They're out there in the public domain. Please do use them. We've got careers videos that are sort of 3 or 4 minutes long that you can use in assemblies, or you can use in meetings, or you can just signpost people to. And I've got three at the moment. They're all spotlight different careers. None of them are RFA yet. I apologise to our VIP guest today, but we've got a young lady who's doing an apprenticeship, I think, in electrical engineering at Peel Ports in Merseyside. We've got a young lady who's training to become a maritime lawyer. We've got one from the south. We've got a super video from the southwest, which looks at a young lad who's got an apprenticeship with Babcock. His apprenticeship is in something like pipe fitting, but it's an engineering apprenticeship, and he's very engaging. He talks about not really knowing what he wanted to do and not being very good at school and all the rest of it. He comes across brilliantly in the video. There's also a young lady who works in a harbour. So where I was talking about ports, harbours and marinas being workplaces and us thinking about them as workplaces, and she's doing marine electrical apprenticeship. And then there's a third one that's based in the solar. It doesn't really matter where they are regionally, because we made sure that there was a good split of roles and organisations, with a young man who is working on tugs, got my dream job, and another young man who is doing engineering in maritime defence for Kinetic. And he talks about scuba diving as part of his work. And there's shots of the water tanks and so on and so on. Those are short videos. We've also got virtual tours, which are proving to be really, really popular. And there's only about 13 of them at the moment, but I'm adding to them. I put in a request yesterday for a virtual tour from a high crane at a port, and I'm hoping that's going to come through. But that's an opportunity for you to see inside a ship, behind the walls of a port and so on. The last time I checked the stats, we posted them as part of Maritime UK Week celebrations, and they've been viewed over 7,000 times on YouTube. So again, little short videos that are really good for job seekers and for young people just to get an insight. We've got longer videos that go into particular industries in more depth. What we would have done formally is the session you've had this morning would have been one of those, really. But we've found that these CPD things are really good. So we look at shipbroking, we look at navigation, we look at the people that work keeping the safety buoys and equipment working for people that are out at sea doing those sorts of jobs in work boats. We've got one on careers at sea, we've got one on how to become a marine biologist, we've got one about how you build a career in conservation. So feel free to use those and to share them. And then most recently, the new resource that we added for National Careers Week and National Apprenticeship Week was 5 questions in 5 minutes. Video case study interviews with maritime people. I've got about 25 of them. I'm in the process of gathering together specific ones in support of marine science for World Oceans Day on the 8th of June. So there's new resources being added to the website all the time. And those people that are in our careers professional network get a newsletter from me only once every 2 months, but with a little update on new resources or activities or what's coming up. I talked about upcoming CPD sessions. So as I said, in June, we have one on super yacht crewing and careers at sea. And in July, we're looking at, we've got one coming up, I think it's the 14th of July, and it's on design careers in maritime. And in the next academic year, I'm doing one in collaboration with Engineering UK, and we're going to look at STEM careers in maritime. I'm doing one on careers in water sports and one on being an instructor, whether that's a yachting sailing instructor or in water sports and so on, and doing a big one on ports. So we've got lots of these things coming up, which hopefully will be of use to you. So I'll stop sharing my screen and come back into the meeting. We lost Stephen. He's come back in. I'm just checking to see if there's any other questions.
I was just replying to someone there on how to prepare for the Admiralty interview board. Basically, I think the best advice I can give is to get on to YouTube and the forums, speak to people on the forums, find out what they've done to prepare for the different things you'll be doing at the Admiralty interview board. But certainly there are videos on there which give an insight as to the what sort of things you'll be assessed on. And also there's publications available from digital bookshops that can give you a good idea on how to prepare for things like the psychometric tests and practical leadership tasks and all the rest of it. So yeah, research is the best way to be prepared for the Admiralty interview board.
Perfect, thank you. We're out of time almost. So what I'm doing is I'm just putting a note in the chat, which is a link to the next lot of CPD sessions. The other thing I would say is that this is a collaborative thing. And if we haven't done a CPD session on an aspect of the maritime sector you think would be useful to your job seekers, your clients, your young people that you're working with, then just let me know and we'll see what we can do for you. But for now, if we've answered all the questions, we're out of time. Steve and Emily, thank you so much. The videos were amazing. I'm not convinced it wasn't you doing the backflip. It looked like you doing the backflip, but you can do another one for us now. That would be awesome. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you to everyone that's joined us this morning. I hope you have found that useful. And you know where I am if there's something else that you're looking for. But please do share what you've learned this morning with your colleagues and the people that you're working with. I will send you a link to this once it's been edited and trimmed and it's uploaded onto the website, and we'll include, if we can, a PDF version of your presentation, Steve, if that's possible.
All right, I'll work on it. Yeah.
Because I think people would like to look at it again when they've got more time. Brilliant, thank you everybody, and we'll see you at the next one, hopefully. Bye for now.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.